So there's a lot further that Bitcoin prices could rise. And I think institutions are starting to recognize that.
Das Jahr hört bullisch auf und das neue Jahr fängt bullisch an, also wahrscheinlich. Das zumindest ist eine der Thesen, die im aktuellen Outlook Report 2025 von CoinShares formuliert werden, den wir vorab exklusiv erhalten haben. Ja, herzlich willkommen zum Experts Podcast. Mein Name ist David Scheider. Ich bin Redakteur bei BTC Echo und zugeschaltet ist heute exklusiv der Head of Research von CoinShares, James Butterfill. CoinShares ist ein europäischer Crypto-Asset-Manager, der vor allem für seine digitalen Anlageprodukte wie Crypto-ETPs bekannt ist. Da James kein Deutsch spricht, ist diese Folge auf Englisch. Du kannst aber auf unserem YouTube-Kanal mit deutschen Untertiteln kannst du die Folge schauen. Und damit wechseln wir jetzt ins Englische. Hi James, how are you?
Hi, nice to meet you. I apologize, I can't speak German for your audience. I'm absolutely hopeless. So it's probably better I speak English.
Definitely. We had your colleague actually a couple of weeks ago, and yeah, it was quite surprising. He was really good German speaker. But it's
yeah, Townsend Lansing. He lived there selling wine for 3 years or something. So yeah, he's developed a good German ability. Yes.
Yeah, and before we dive in, we have to watch the Bitcoin chart closely. It sits at 98K, so we might witness Bitcoin breaking 100K for the first time.
Well, we have it live. Can you see here? I have the block clock here. That's live. And you see the price changing all the time. So every 5 minutes it updates. So yes, this may happen live on the chart. So
that's sort of a proof of price, I would say.
Yeah.
For the recording. All right. Yeah, James, let's dive in. Let's start with Bitcoin itself. Your report was a bit about Bitcoin, but also about altcoins. But let's start with Bitcoin first. And one of the standout themes in your report is the idea that Bitcoin is moving closer to mainstream financial markets, especially if you consider the record-breaking ETFs. And I was wondering, how significant is this shift and what does it mean for Bitcoin's status as an asset?
Yeah, I think Bitcoin has been slowly moving more in line with certain assets in the traditional finance world. That's not to say it's being assimilated by the financial world at all. It's just that it you can define Bitcoin. And I think people are starting to trade it in what it fundamentally is. So I think Bitcoin is this, I would describe it as an emerging store of value, a bit like gold, but it differs from gold and it has this growth component to it. So it was born from the internet. So when the internet grows, Bitcoin's likely to grow with it. That will not be the case for something like gold in that respect. And you know, it is an asset of fixed supply. And it's theoretically one of the hardest assets in the world. You can't change the supply of Bitcoin at all, really. It's easier to change the supply of gold because you can just go out and dig more gold out of the ground. But with Bitcoin, it's an incredibly hard asset. And for that reason, it is a store of value. And it's slowly establishing that identity as a store of value. And I think the first signs we really got, we've been thinking about it as a store of value for the last 5 years. But the first true signs, I think, that it was behaving like that was in January 2022. So back at that point, we had the US Federal Reserve talking about inflation, and it wasn't transitory. And suddenly in January 2022, they said inflation isn't transitory anymore. There's a problem with inflation and we need to start hiking rates aggressively. Now, at that point, they started raising interest rates, well, in March that year. And suddenly Bitcoin, as a store of value, was competing with other stores of value like treasuries and like gold. And because suddenly treasuries look more attractive because the yields were rising, people started selling Bitcoin and they started selling gold. You know, ultimately, we had a period in 2021 where people were very euphoric about Bitcoin, and ultimately the Fed popped the bubble, the Bitcoin bubble. And then if you look at that point, ever since that period in 2022, whenever we get interest rate sensitive data come out, like inflation data or employment data, particularly in the US, you see Bitcoin immediately react intraday to that data, and it's telling you it's slowly establishing itself from a trader's perspective, at least, as this store of value. I'm not negating the other merits that Bitcoin has, but and you can see that. And now we're in a situation where the Fed is starting to cut interest rates. And look at Bitcoin. I mean, we've seen $13 billion of inflows into Bitcoin ETFs since the Fed cut rates. And, you know, the prospect is that they'd like to continue to cut rates. And of course, we've had various political issues as well that have been very supportive for Bitcoin. So yes, it is establishing itself as this store of value, and it's trading very much that way in the financial world, at least.
So the Bitcoin ETFs were really, really successful. It was the most successful Bitcoin ETFs of all time. Not only Bitcoin ETFs, but ETFs of all time. Were you surprised of how fast it went and how much money went into the ETFs?
The answer is no. I mean, the market is full of a lot of speculation, as you would expect with any. We've witnessed the birth of a new asset class, so it is to be expected to see this huge growth and excitement about it. You know, this year alone, we've seen over $40 billion worth of inflows into Bitcoin, and the price is reacting commensurately. So, yeah, it doesn't really surprise me. I think it's a really positive sign for things. I think what we're starting to see, what's evident with the ETF data, is that we're seeing early signs of institutions participating. I mean, what's been really unusual in the birth of this new asset class and the advent of ETFs and ETCs, etc., is that it's something that retail have got to first. It's individuals. You know, a lot of the original trading, not just ETFs in Bitcoin, was done on exchanges, and it was generally ridiculed by institutional investors. But that's changing now. And I think that's partly because Bitcoin is a complicated thing. It's very volatile, and that has put investors off. But slowly but surely, they're starting to see that this is actually a really valid asset and useful asset in the world. You know, it has many kind of merits as an investment, not just as a store of value. It's, if you're running a political campaign against Putin in Russia, you probably are getting your bank account shut down by Putin. So the only option is Bitcoin. So it has many kind of, it provides many solutions for people around the world. And so I'm not surprised we've seen such excitement around it.
So are you saying the greatest bulk of the inflows were retail investors, or rather institutions such as hedge funds?
Well, I mean, we've had the ETF launches in the US this year, before the ETF launches in the US. I estimate around 90% were retail. And then when we had the launches in the US, suddenly, because prior to that, we had a lot of investors in Europe saying, I'm not sure, you know, my peers aren't investing in Bitcoin. I still worry about a government ban. I'm not going to invest. But now we've had ETF launches in the US and a lot of institutions buying. Suddenly, we're seeing a lot of European investors say, actually, you know, maybe it is all right. It's not damaging to my reputation to invest. So this year so far, I'd say it's been more like 60% retail and 40% institutional. So a big change from what it was in prior years.
Do you think that continues next year? So that is like the shift from retail to institutional, and will next year even break the record? You said 40 billion inflows. Next year it's going to be the same or more?
I think what's really great about the US ETF world is and the SEC data is that they compile investor holdings or called 13F filing data. And you can see what investors are doing with quite a high degree of detail. And what it tells you is that, yeah, we are getting Goldman Sachs and hedge funds like Millennium buying digital assets, Bitcoin ETFs. But still, a lot of institutions, a lot of banks haven't bought yet. So I think next year we could see another very solid year of inflows. you know, we've only really seen the government in the US really accept Bitcoin. You know, the government's now talking about, in the US, is talking about Bitcoin becoming a strategic reserve asset. I think that is bigger than the ETF news. So we could see huge inflows next year because the government condoning Bitcoin, accepting it, and having it as a strategic reserve asset is a huge sort of box-ticking thing for the rest of the corporate and institutional investor world. The government's buying it. Why shouldn't they? There's no stigma against not buying it. So I think on the one hand, it's very difficult to quantify how much inflows we could see, but they could be huge given what's being proposed. I mean, it's not just the US government, by the way. We've seen Saudi Arabia and several other governments mining Bitcoin. Saudi Arabia is talking about it being a strategic reserve asset as well. It does kind of make sense given what it is. But yeah, I think we're only on the cusp now of institutional investors buying digital assets. So still very early. And, you know, you could say, oh, well, the Bitcoin price has gone up so much. Why buy now? Well, you know, if it is competing with other digital assets such as gold, such as M2 money reserves, central bank reserves, etc. You know, look, in gold, at the price it is now, nearly 100,000, that only represents 10% of gold's market share. You know, at 25% of gold's market share is 250,000. So there's a lot further that Bitcoin prices could rise. And I think institutions are starting to recognize that.
Mm. What will that do to volatility? Like, if more and more people get involved, I can't really, do you think it's going to be more volatile in the future, also in terms of like bear markets, if like sort of newcomer retail people that aren't really experienced don't know about the halving cycles? I think, or you could make the hypothesis that the downturns are going to get worse, or will they be maybe even smoothed out and are going to be not so bad as in the future? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, Bitcoin has historically been more volatile when prices are rising than when it's falling. But there's a slight difference to history now. So because institutional investors are buying Bitcoin, they tend to do something called rebalancing. So they might decide that they want a 4% target weight of Bitcoin in their portfolio. And every quarter, they will rebalance. So if the price falls below their original 4% investment, they will buy more Bitcoin to get back to that 4% target. And if the price rises, they will sell more Bitcoin. They will sell their Bitcoin to go back to that 4% target. And that's a very common practice amongst institutional investors. And that in a grander scale will actually, I think, likely push volatility down over time. And we're seeing evidence of that already. You know, in this kind of price movement in the past, we could have seen Bitcoin vol hit 100%. But at the moment, actually, the volatility is more like 40%. And it's generally trending down over time. And if you just extrapolate that long-term trend towards in the future, what you find is by around 2026, 2027, the volatility of Bitcoin is likely to be similar to something like an emerging market equity asset or something like that. So, long-term, I expect the effect of portfolio rebalancing that I mentioned is likely to see lower volatility.
Interesting.
That's not always a good thing, by the way. That's not always a good thing because some investors really like the volatility. They like those sharp snapbacks to give them another opportunity to add more Bitcoin to their portfolios.
Right. Like professional people probably like that, and retail get a bit scared at some points. I mean, yeah. I don't know how much Bitcoin dropped after the last bear market, but it was like 70% for people that got in a couple of years before. That's kind of scary. So I probably would personally appreciate a bit less volatility. But, yeah. Let's talk a bit about regulation. In your report, you also talk about politics. We have a new administration soon in the US, which is pretty bullish for Bitcoin, I would say. With a pro-crypto US administration in place, what kind of regulatory changes do you foresee for the crypto market?
Yeah, I think Bitcoin, so we run this survey every quarter asking investors what are their key concerns, and it tracks fund managers, it tracks in total around $1 trillion of assets under management. So not a bad sample size. And what it highlights is the biggest concern amongst investors is over 50% say when they're asked the question, what worries you, what are the key risks about Bitcoin and digital assets generally, it is about a government ban and politics. And the really positive thing that we're seeing now is that although that's very high, their concerns are very high, we're seeing governments decide to regulate rather than ban. The only sort of government now that's still banning Bitcoin to some extent is the UK government. In Europe, we have MiCAR, the Markets and Crypto Assets Regulation, which focuses a lot around marketing of Bitcoin and other digital assets. And in the US, now we've seen obviously a vastly improved political situation. And Donald Trump has already talked about removing Gary Gensler, who has adopted, who's part of, who's head of the SEC. He's adopted a what people are saying is lawfare or regulation by enforcement, i.e. putting in people in prison rather than saying, hey, can you change? And I think with the removal of someone like Gary Gensler, I think we'll see a much more constructive SEC and a much more sort of much less kind of stance towards lawfare. And so I think that'd be very positive. And if you look outside of Europe and the US, we're seeing Dubai having quite constructive regulatory stance. We're seeing in Hong Kong the same thing happen, and in Australia. So the really positive thing, though a lot of investors are quite worried about a politics or government ban, it's becoming very evident that governments are choosing to regulate and not ban. And I think in the end, this is an asset that the only way of banning it is turning the internet off. And that has huge economic implications of doing so. So I think that's incredibly unlikely. You can't really ban Bitcoin. You can ban on and off ramps. But even there, you know, Nigeria is a really good example where you try to ban Bitcoin and it's become increasingly popular as a consequence. So it's something that's not going away. So it is actually much more sensible to try and regulate rather than ban.
Yeah. I didn't have the US making Bitcoin a strategic reserve asset in the United States on my bingo card. So that was quite surprising for me. Do you think that's likely that Trump actually does that?
Well, if you look at the Poly market, a good sort of odds checking website, a gambling site in some respects, a decentralized one, by the way, they're sort of pricing only around a 28 to 30% likeliness of this occurring. There is a, I suppose, that surprised me. I mean, because we had Senator Cynthia Lummis, she's a Republican senator, propose this at Bitcoin Nashville. And we had suspected that some government would do this, but we hadn't suspected the US would. And we also thought with the election, you know, what happens if the Republicans win the Senate but they don't have the House? Then it's less likely. But now we've seen a clean sweep. So the Republicans have both the Senate and the House. I think this kind of proposal is much more likely. And he has people advising him that are quite pro-crypto, such as Donald Trump does, such as Elon Musk, who we know is quite pro-crypto. So I think this is becoming increasingly likely. But yeah, Donald Trump's not in power yet. but I would be, it may happen a bit later than we expect, but I'd be hugely surprised if it didn't happen now.
Mm-hmm. And if it happened, what would it mean for Bitcoin?
Well, the US have said they would buy 1 million Bitcoin. So that would make them one of the largest holders in the world. It's actually, the grand scheme, it's not a huge amount of Bitcoin. But I think the more positive thing we can take away from this is the largest government in the world deciding to hold Bitcoin. That means anyone that's been worried about, as an investor in particular, that's been worried about buying Bitcoin because it would damage their reputation. That stigma around Bitcoin is gone now. I mean, in fact, just the fact that we have senators in the United States talking about Bitcoin as a strategic reserve asset, even if they do it or not, this is a massive improvement in Bitcoin's reputation in particular. So, you know, the genie's out now. We have other governments looking at doing the same thing. And we know many governments are mining Bitcoin now as well. So, yeah, it was very interesting for us because we've been speaking to investors for many years now. And there's 5 years I've been speaking to investors. I can't tell you how much I've said. Even 5 years ago, we've had investors saying, yes, I have Bitcoin in my personal account, but I'm not adding it to my corporate account, my institutional investment account. Now that goes away. And we know secretly a lot of people really like Bitcoin in the institutional world. So this is a very positive thing. And I think could be the big story of 2025. And as a consequence, actually could be a lot more price supportive than even the ETFs were this year.
Mm. Yeah, that sounds like it. Do you think like also other states could potentially diversify away from the US dollar? The US dollar is a reserve currency, but you could argue that it's declining as a its status as a reserve currency. Do you see also other states diversifying into Bitcoin as a reserve asset, maybe?
So, yeah, I mean, the evidence is that the dollar's reserve currency status is slowly being eroded. You need an asset that's very free and easy to use. The reality with owning the dollar is that there's a huge amount of regulation involved, a huge amount of, you know, the US saying, look, if you want to own and use the dollar, you have to adhere to all these long lists of rules. They call it the hegemony of the US dollar. So it's increasingly hard to do that. And people are looking for alternatives. That's part of the reason why stablecoins, like US dollar stablecoins, have been so popular. You don't need to adhere to all the FATCA rules and everything else to own the dollar. But yeah, the dollar is slowly being eroded. And if you look at, say, the recent BRICS event this summer, you see that the BRICS countries, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, and others, are talking about potentially proposing Bitcoin as a currency they use for international trade. I'm not saying that will happen. I think the likeliness of that at the moment, at least, is still quite low. But yeah, it's certainly people are exploring this idea. And I think the more that Bitcoin becomes, the volatility declines, I think the prospects for it being used as this as an international kind of reserve asset or trading asset increases or, you know, exponentially.
Mm-hmm. Also, a big factor for the recent price action and price action this year are companies accumulating Bitcoin, and you have to name MicroStrategy in that instance. Do you see other companies also adopting such a Bitcoin reserve strategy, such as MicroStrategy, next year?
Well, I met Michael Saylor last week in Miami. It's very evident he's not going to stop buying Bitcoin. I'd say his company is the exception rather than the rule in terms of just how much Bitcoin he's buying. You know, he's I think proposed to buy another $42 billion over the next 5 years of Bitcoin. There's a name for these companies that are buying Bitcoin now. They're calling it Bitcoin yielding companies. So what percentage of Bitcoin do these companies own as a percentage of the total number of shares outstanding? And what Michael Saylor is slowly doing is increasing that Bitcoin yield, so to speak. And there are other companies starting to do the same thing. A lot of them are Bitcoin mining companies, but we've got a recent company we invested into in Japan called Metaplanet that are doing it now. So there is around, we think, around 40 to 50 companies now putting Bitcoin on as a kind of treasury reserve asset on balance sheet, and so that was one company 3 years ago. It's now around 40 or 50 today. Many companies are concerned about the dollar. That people hold the dollar, on as a treasury reserve to help balance out FX variations, because maybe they're an international company and trade in lots of different currencies. So it kind of makes sense for some who are worried about the dollar and its reserve currency status that they do own a little bit of Bitcoin to kind of balance out their risks, FX risks, they're called.
Mm. Yeah, I was wondering if there are like also risks involved. Probably there are. MicroStrategy doesn't really have a business model instead of simply buying Bitcoin, I suppose, and making more and more debt buying Bitcoin. Do you think that's a sustainable business model?
This is a big question. some people, there's a fine line between genius and madness, right? And where does Michael Saylor sit on that spectrum is quite difficult to tell, if I'm really honest. He's basically gaming the convertible bonds market at the moment and dominating it. And actually for many convertible bond investors that want to own Bitcoin, it's quite an easy way to do it. You know, he's basically proposing, his belief is that Bitcoin rises 20% year on year. He will offer a convertible bond coupon at 5%. So he makes 15% upside. For him, that's a no-brainer. But there are some risks to that strategy. So what happens if the Bitcoin price falls for a sustainable period of time? But his average purchase price, even after the most recent purchase he did last week, his average purchase price is $50,000 per Bitcoin. So you would need to see Bitcoin fall below $50,000 for a long period of time. So he has around 10% of his business is now the tech business, the software business. Earnings season wasn't great for that business, but it's become a bit of a sideshow. But he still needs to support that business. But he has enough Bitcoin reserves, and he wouldn't have to start selling Bitcoin until it's at 50,000. But not just that, for a long period of time, for maybe a year or so, it needs to be below that point before he's having to start selling Bitcoin. And it's only then that he starts to have solvency issues. So I think you have to have quite a bearish view on the Bitcoin price, and for quite a long period of time the whole MicroStrategy Bitcoin purchasing strategy all falls to pieces. It is extreme, and something else could break. It's a bit difficult to see what at the moment, but something else could break in the markets that cause MicroStrategy to fall from grace. So I do think, you have to enter into that company now with a bit of caution, and perhaps in the future, as more companies sort of adopt a strategy, MicroStrategy doesn't look quite so attractive.
Hmm. Yeah. In recent weeks, Bitcoin really exploded. I wrote an article today, and I saw that Bitcoin is up 40% in a month. That's kind of crazy. But before, we had that long sideways trend and people started to get a bit nervous about the price. Do you have any insights on why price was so low for the majority of this year?
Well, we were still, sitting on like 40% gains earlier on in the year in sort of May time. It's not that bad in the broader scheme of things. But I think what's happened between then and now is two things. We've had the halving, where the total amount of Bitcoin produced every day by miners has gone from 900 to 450 a day. And no one quite knew what kind of effect that might have. The idea was it would really push up price. I don't believe that to be the case, because this is perfectly known information. You can project all the halvings out within a month's accuracy for the next 100 years. So it's not like suddenly the supply is halved and we didn't know about it. But I do think that's led a few question marks over the miners and what would happen there. And then I think the big one is around regulation and the US government and the election. That was a big overhang. No one quite knew what would happen. Yeah, if the Democrats got back in, it perhaps wouldn't be such a supportive environment for Bitcoin. And I think that it's only on a very simplistic level, it's only those kind of two factors that I think, have really hung over the Bitcoin price, and probably why it just sort of has treaded water for the last 6 months until the most recent, until September, ultimately.
Mm. And you were telling about the survey that you did with investors, asking about why they would not invest in Bitcoin. And you said like political risks were sort of quite high now that there are less and less political risks, but there probably are still factors that why people are not investing in Bitcoin. So what are the most common reasons for investors to avoid Bitcoin?
Yeah, so I mean, this survey was taken in September, so up to the end of September, so prior to the knowledge of the US elections. So yeah, it doesn't surprise me that politics and the government ban was still very high. But if you look at some of the other issues that people have, the hang-ups, volatility is one. A lot of people don't like the volatility of Bitcoin and therefore very conscious of that. The other one is protocol design. So some people are concerned that, you know, Bitcoin, its transactions per second are quite low, so it couldn't really operate particularly well as a currency. And I agree, it couldn't. But there is this thing called the Lightning Network, which hasn't taken off in substantial, but it's something that El Salvador have adopted. And that solves that technical problem. There's still those protocol designs. People have those niggling kind of questions about, well, you know, what happens if one miner gets all control, you know, more than 50% control of the mining network? I think it would be very much against their own interests to change or fiddle with the code in that respect. But there's always that, I suppose, that potential risk. Or what happens if a government comes in and starts mining Bitcoin like at more than 50% or something like that, and again tries to sabotage Bitcoin? That kind of scenario is hugely unlikely, just given how much you'd have to invest and how much power you would need. A Bitcoin is secured by electricity and power generation, and you know the amount you would need, it would be an obscene amount of power and a huge amount of logistics and a huge amount of mining hardware. I don't think any government can achieve that level of control over it. But yeah, they're the kind of niggling issues, and the other ones I think are a headache post FTX about custody of Bitcoin. And some people are worried, you know, you've got this USB stick. Is it safe on that USB stick? What happens if I lose it? And that's why something like an ETF, I think, is becoming one of the favored options to own Bitcoin, because you're leaving an expert like CoinShares, like us, to have very high grade, very secure custody solutions, rather than having it on just a USB stick at home, for instance.
Mm. Yeah, I could tell that for next year you are probably quite bullish, at least that's what I was hearing. But there must be also risks involved in for next year, for instance, maybe recession risks or monetary policy change risks. What kind of risks do you see for the crypto market in the coming year?
Good question. I think initially that there is quite high risk, I think, of a recession in Europe broadly. I know Germany's struggling economically at the moment, but I think it could leak out to the rest of Europe in that respect. And actually, I think the US is not such a positive place economically either. We saw an inkling of that with the recent payroll figures, which were very weak. So I think initially a recession in Europe and the US wouldn't be good for risk assets. I actually don't think Bitcoin is a risk asset. It's a risky asset. It's volatile. But I think it is a store of value. But an initial recession shock, I think, could push down the prices of Bitcoin. But it would also recover. I think it would lead to weakening of the US dollar, a weakening of the euro, a recession, and people would be then looking for stores of value and alternatives. And so whilst it could create a dip down in price initially, I think it would be quite supportive for Bitcoin in the longer term. And we've seen that during periods of economic stress. So a good example is the crisis of banks in the United States in 2023. Led to a lot of investors buying Bitcoin because they're so worried about the banking system. The other scenario is more around inflation. So let's say we have the crisis in Russia or in the Middle East escalates more and we see an oil embargo and oil prices go crazy. I think, again, initially that'd be quite bad for something like Bitcoin because we would see inflation rise quite sharply and then central banks would have to react. They'd have to raise interest rates to try and curb that oil price problem. But this would, in the longer term, again, highlight a problem and highlight the impotency of central banks. If you are having to raise rates because of external inflation factors that you can't control, such as oil prices raising, whilst your domestic economy is really suffering, raising rates in that interest rates in that scenario is a very difficult thing. And actually, I think, again, investors would recognize the impotency of central banks in their ability to control inflation. And again, I think might turn to something like Bitcoin. So again, initially, an inflation shock would be bad for Bitcoin. But again, in the longer term, I think it would be probably quite supportive of Bitcoin prices.
Everything is good for Bitcoin.
Yeah, in the longer term, yeah, I do. What's the end game for Bitcoin? This is an important question. You know, does everyone then adopt Bitcoin? I don't think I've got that fully articulated in my mind because I do think it would be quite economically unsettling for countries, everyone to adopt Bitcoin. As well. So I know that in a Bitcoin maxi world, that is the scenario, but I think it would lead to a lot of economic instability in the short term. And when I say in the short term, in that view, I mean over the next 5 years, if that was what's really going to happen, that would take a lot of adjustments to the way things work in our economies for that to occur. I think the scenario that I'm playing out in my head is probably one where it's a very slow adoption of Bitcoin. And we have a period where people use Bitcoin and their domestic currencies at the same time. That's a more likely scenario. I don't think it's going to be a shock and everyone starts using it. I think we will see slow adoption of Bitcoin.
Yeah. For the end of our episode, let's quickly touch upon also altcoins, especially like Ethereum is really lagging behind. And in terms of dominance, Bitcoin is really ripping this year, actually. Like, I think from 50% dominance at the beginning of the year, and now it's sitting at 62%. So Bitcoin is really performing even better than the altcoin sector. Do you think that's going to continue next year, or will we see like some sort of an altcoin season? And if so, what kind of coins are you most bullish on?
Yeah. I do. I mean, Ethereum has some technical challenges that have favored Solana up until now in that respect. So Ethereum is a much bigger network than Solana. It has a much greater developer network. So there's around 1,000 active developers on Solana. There's more like, if you include Base and the developers there, which operates on Solana, it's more like 6,500 devs. So the prospects of something positive great being built on Ethereum are better, I think, than Solana. But Ethereum, I mean, I do suggest, you know, if Solana got to the same size and scale as Ethereum, would it be facing similar problems? I think probably yes. But Solana is trying to address these problems. It had an upgrade middle this year called Demkun, where ultimately it meant executing transactions on layer two networks became incredibly cheap. but that was also a problem for Solana, for Ethereum. So its layer one fees have fallen dramatically to the point where it's nowhere near as profitable as it used to be. And this has actually become a problem. So we're seeing a huge increase in usage in layer two solutions like Arbitrum and Optimism and Base, a big uptick. So there's almost been an unintended consequence of making the layer two so good and easy to use that the fees have dropped. Now, people are concerned about that point. Like, what's the value proposition of Ethereum now? You would have to see layer two solutions such as Base and Arbitrum and Optimism rise so much to offset those drops in fees that it's a bit imbalanced. And that's that's what I think worried investors. There has been a proposal made called Beamchain that reorders the way in which the sort of network upgrades will occur for Ethereum. And that's received some positive. Recently we've seen, I think, $660 million of inflows into Bitcoin last week alone, and so into Ethereum, sorry, last week. So that's very positive there. So that does suggest those recent Beamchain proposals are quite supportive for Ethereum. And perhaps Ethereum can regain some of its lost dominance relative to Bitcoin. Solana has been, you know, very popular. It's basically very similar to Ethereum in many respects. And it has brokered deals with various banks and other institutions to operate on it. And it's quite easy to use. But don't forget, something like Solana, 80% of Solana's trading is meme coins. Is that genuinely sustainable? You have to ask yourself that question. Those meme coins now could move back to trading on Ethereum. Now it's a lot cheaper to run. So there's a risk there for Solana. But at the moment, yeah, it's been a darling amongst investors this year. But longer term, will that remain the case? And you have to then, if you look out across a lot of other altcoins, you know, why own them? Why own something like Cardano? It's an Ethereum clone in some respects. Can it, what is the price driver for that? And I think for a lot of altcoins, they need to establish a niche for themselves, whether that's in NFTs or gaming or something like that. You know, the low hanging fruit of that, say, Ethereum is captured with DeFi or Bitcoin is captured as a store of value, you know, can you challenge that? And the answer is probably no. A lot of success around cryptocurrencies is their network, how big their network is. And Bitcoin's established a huge network. So is Ethereum and Solana a little bit. If you can't capture that network through token incentives that a lot of them offer, i.e. the staking yields, how is it going to gain popularity? And I do think we'll see a huge attrition in a lot of, someone said there's over a sort of 14 million cryptocurrencies now. Some are being popular through memes like Dogecoin. And so there is this kind of meme investing strategy. It's something that's very hard, I think, to quantify and be successful in. Pump.fun is a good example where if you invested in all the Pump.fun coins, you would have lost quite a lot of money, actually. There are individual stories of great success there. But some of them, there was a meme coin, I think, created, someone highlighted to me about the squirrel in the US election, and that had rallied massively. But that's like, as an investor, is that really, how can you capture that? I mean, it's very hard. So I think these altcoins have to find a niche. And, you know, there are sort of coins like Chainalysis, which is, not Chainalysis, that's a forensics company, like Chainlink, for instance, where, you know, it's about interoperability between different cryptocurrencies. I think that makes sense. I'm not so sure that Bitcoin is, its dominance is going to subside in 2025. It's got a lot of things going for it next year, you know, particularly the Bitcoin Act and institutional investors going. And institutional investors, they're very much focused on Bitcoin and Ethereum, not much else at the moment. I don't know if we'll see altcoin season like many people have seen in the past. I don't think it will be the same.
Sweet. Yeah, we're slowly coming to an end. Maybe before we go, let our listeners know where they can find your new report and outlook for 2025.
Yeah, so it'll be published on coinshares.com/research. You'll find it there. There'll also be sort of various derivatives of it on our blog, which is blog.coinshares.com. It'd be great for you to go there.
Sweet. Yeah, to our listeners, thanks for tuning in. What are your predictions for 2025? Do you also see Bitcoin dominance continue to rip? Leave a comment on YouTube. And James, thanks for being my guest at the BTC Echo Experts podcast. That was really, really valuable for me. Thanks for coming.